The next item of business is a statement by Shona Robison on strengthened fire alarm standards. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement and hence there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary, up to 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The law on fire alarms is changing from the 1st of February in Scotland, and there have been calls for a further delay to this legislation, but having considered the balance of risks, I'm clear that it's not right to delay the legislation that is designed to protect and save lives. Ensuring people are safe from risk of fire in their homes is a key priority for the Scottish Government. These improved standards will reduce the risk of injury and death in house fires. One death from fire in Scotland's homes is one death too many. Following the tragedy at Grenfell, the Scottish Government carried out a public consultation in 2017, which showed very strong support for a new minimum standard for fire and smoke detectors across all housing, regardless of tenure. This legislation brings all homes to the same standard. So, for example, it ensures that social rented homes have the same fire standards, safety standards that have been in law for nearly a decade for the private rented sector. It ensures that owner-occupied homes have the same safety standards that new-build homes have had for nearly 15 years. From the 1st of February, the standard means all houses should have interlinked alarms, with one smoke alarm in the living room, one in each hallway and landing, a heat alarm in the kitchen and a carbon monoxide detector in each room with a carbon-fueled appliance such as a gas boiler or fire. These alarms will support greater fire safety and prevent avoidable death. An interlinked alarm means that when one alarm goes off in one part of the house, the rest also go off, which of course means, for example, if someone is sleeping in a bedroom away from the kitchen where a fire starts, all the alarms will go off and people are alerted to the danger. These alarms are very similar to the fire alarms people will already have, but that important interlinking provides that extra safety. And whilst they can be wired into homes, most are the same as fire alarms people now have, battery operated, but they can effectively communicate with each other. Figures from the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service show that in 2020 to 2021, there were 44 deaths due to house fires in Scotland. In the 4 years from 2014 to 2018, where fatalities were recorded, on average 30% of fires started in the living room and 15% in the kitchen. In 52% of domestic fire incidents, a smoke alarm had alerted occupants to the fact that there was a fire, giving people a greater chance of escape. Interlinked fire and smoke alarms increase the chance of being alerted more quickly by all going off simultaneously, regardless of where the fire starts. That is why we have introduced the same standards for all properties. We're asking the social rented sector to make this change for their tenants, and we know this has well progressed. We're also asking people who own their own homes to take this step. Scottish Government has already made over £15 million of loan funding available for social landlords to procure and install the necessary alarms, which should help ensure that social tenants are safe in their homes. At an expected average cost of around £220 and sometimes less, I hope these new fire alarm standards will be viewed as part of ongoing improvements for people who own their own homes, one that will protect their property and importantly can save lives. I know, however, people are feeling the cost of living squeeze right now and might feel that they don't have the money available. So I'd like to make 2 points. For those who own their home who are at high risk of fire or who are elderly or disabled, we've provided £1.5 million through the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and Care and Repair Scotland to support homeowners to have appropriate alarms fitted. Second, it is local authorities who have the duty for ensuring compliance with these standards in their local area. And they will be taking a proportionate and measured approach to compliance, taking individual circumstances into account, as well as reflecting the evolving situation with the COVID-19 pandemic. I can be absolutely clear that there are no penalties for non-compliance, and no one will be penalised if they need more time, although I strongly encourage all homeowners to make these changes and benefit from the improved protection against loss of life and property in the event of a fire. We have progressed a full awareness-raising campaign through 2021, and COSLA have confirmed that there will be a measured and proportionate approach to compliance as well. These changes, including the timing of implementation, have been carefully considered and consulted on over a number of years. Following the Grenfell Tower fire, the Scottish Government undertook a review of Scotland's building and fire safety regulatory frameworks. As part of this work, we prioritised a consultation on fire and smoke alarms. This consultation went ahead in 2017 with a wide range of respondents. There was very strong support for a common new minimum standard for fire and smoke detectors across all housing. People told us they were in favour of swift action with a proposed one-year period of introduction of regulations, but in response to specific concerns from some stakeholders about the time needed for carrying out the work, ministers agreed that the regulations should allow a period of 2 years for compliance. The regulations introducing the new standard were unanimously supported by members of the Cross-Party Local Government and Communities Committee of the Scottish Parliament on the 19th of December 2018. These regulations were set in law on the 16th of January 2019 and were intended to come into force on the 1st of February 2021. However, in the light of the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic during 2020, there were concerns about how the pandemic would impact on homeowners' ability to make changes to their homes in time for this original deadline. So a delay of 12 months was sought by ministers and agreed at the Local Government and Communities Committee meeting in December 2020. As was stated at that time, a longer delay was not right, as any delay to the regulation is a delay to a measure that has the potential to protect lives. And that's why we remain committed to bringing in these new standards from the 1st of February 2022. I hope I've already provided reassurance as to the need for these measures to improve fire safety in all types of home and to protect lives. But let me also address the other issues that I've heard raised. I'm aware of some concerns about the validity of home insurance policies if compliance with the new legislation is not met. And we'd assure people that this is not the case. We've engaged proactively with the Association of British Insurers throughout the legislative process, and they have ensured their members were aware of the changes and have stated that while insurers may ask customers questions about whether the property is fitted with working fire alarms, they are not likely to ask questions about specific standards. Anyone who is unclear on their policy terms and conditions in relation to the new law should speak to their insurer. Public awareness of the changes to these regulations is now high. The Scottish Government ran an intensive awareness media campaign over 5 weeks in the summer of 2021 across TV, radio and digital platforms. This reached 95% of all adults across Scotland, with 85% of those seeing the campaign at least three times with this vital public information message. In addition, over 96,000 printed leaflets have been supplied to libraries across Scotland, and we've regularly updated our dedicated website with information and advice and distributed an electronic toolkit of resources to key stakeholders. The campaign was shown by independent researchers to have engaged the target audience, driven awareness of the new legislation, and encouraged people to take action. Further research carried out in December 2021 showed that 88% of homeowners were aware of the new legislation. We've also made materials available so that MSPs can inform their constituents about the important changes to fire alarms from February this year. I wrote to all MSPs last autumn with further information and frequently asked questions, and following this statement, I intend to write again to all MSPs providing the most up-to-date information to support you in responding to questions from your constituents. This increased level of awareness led to significant public interest in complying with the new standard, which is welcome. But I am aware that there have been challenges in meeting this demand, exacerbated by global supply shortages of component parts and in the supply of suitable tradespeople to carry out work in people's homes. As of this morning, my officials have confirmed that fire alarms are currently available for purchase and delivery where the manufacturer has a UK supply chain. Some manufacturers of fire alarms continue to have supply chain issues with imported components, which does limit the availability of their alarms for immediate purchase. But as I've said before, the legislation makes allowance for the reasonable additional time needed in this situation. In closing, it's really important that I reiterate that in setting a new standard for fire alarms for homeowners and social landlords, bringing standards in line with other types of home, our foremost goal is to protect life and prevent avoidable deaths in the event of a fire.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. And it would be helpful if those members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak button now or to enter R in the chat room. And I call Miles Briggs.
Thank you. Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement as well. But there is nothing new in this statement today, and I think that will be of concern to many householders across Scotland. The Cabinet Secretary spoke about the awareness campaign and claimed that public awareness of these regulations is now high. However, the Scottish Government's own evaluation report published this week shows that just 1 in 10 households are not aware of this new legislation, a significant number. These regulations were postponed a year ago, and I think that was a welcome step forward, given the fact that we saw the outcome of COVID-19 on homeowners, especially elderly and vulnerable homeowners not wanting workmen coming into their homes. And I think that was a proper step forward. But can I ask the Cabinet Secretary why, in this case, given that the actual COVID restrictions are not going to be lifted until Monday, why she hasn't heard that call again? And can I also ask specifically, how many households now does the Cabinet Secretary believe in Scotland still need to have these devices fitted? It's really important, given the fact that this comes into force in just 13 days' time.
Cabinet Secretary.
So, can I first of all say to Miles Briggs that the important thing here is to get on with supporting and encouraging homeowners to put in these devices which potentially could save lives. And I hope we all agree on the importance of that. In terms of the awareness of the changes, as I said in my statement, the independent analysis shows that, that at the end of last year, 88% of homeowners were aware of the new legislation. And I know from my own mailbag, in terms of people asking some questions around this, that awareness is high. In terms of the question he asked about how many, as I answered in my answer to Sarah Boyack during portfolio questions, we won't know the answer to that until we have the Scottish Household Survey, which will ask that question. But again, I would just reiterate, you know, this is a measure that is important that homeowners take, and of course we're only talking about homeowners here. Private rented tenants and social rented tenants will have that device provided already or will be coming by their landlord. This is for homeowners, and it is really important that homeowners prioritise getting these devices installed because it literally could save lives.
And I call Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We support this vital fire safety improvement, but if homeowners can't comply, then this measure won't start saving the lives we hope it will. And the pensioner who called me yesterday panicking their insurance will be invalidated was the latest who wants to comply but can't get the kit until March. The Association of British Insurers have said, insurers will expect that households are compliant with any legislation, but not likely to ask questions about specific standards, but that it's up to individual insurers to decide how to respond to that new standard. Now, does the Cabinet Secretary accept that insurers will have every right to interpret the legal enforcement date and the standards as the one in law, and relying on them maybe not being likely to ask questions doesn't give homeowners the assurance that they deserve? Letting that happen when so many homeowners can't get access to alarms is bad policy. So will the Cabinet Secretary instruct a formal delay and give homeowners more time to source the alarms and comply?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I don't believe that would be the right thing to do because there's already been a delay. And at the end of the day, what we're talking about here are devices which has the potential to save lives. And I don't think it would be right. And if I had a further delay, I think questions would be quite rightly being asked of me that given these are potentially life-saving devices, is it right to delay these regulations coming in? So I don't think it's right to delay, but I do recognise the issues that the member quite rightly raises. So let me reiterate again around the work that we've done with the Association of British Insurers, who understand these issues very well indeed. And that's why they have been discussing with their members and ensuring their members are aware of the changes and have stated very clearly that while insurers may ask customers about whether the property is fitted with working fire alarms, it's not likely that they would ask about specific standards. That is the practice within the insurance industry. However, as I said in my statement, anyone who is unsure or unclear on their policy terms and conditions in relation to the new law should, in the first instance, speak to their insurer. In terms of access to alarms, I recognise that over the last few months there have been issues, but I have asked my officials on a regular basis to check the availability in Scotland through either internet in terms of UK supply chains or indeed some well-known DIY retailers, and they have told me that the availability of devices has improved and that the cost is around that £200 mark where they are fitted themselves. Now, I also understand about people who might struggle, and that's why care and repair services have dealt with just short of 2,500 inquiries about fire alarms since September of last year, and have been supporting people either through the installation of them or subsidised alarms to make sure that people can get them who would be struggling. So I think we have done what we can. And just finally on this point, local authorities through COSLA have said that they will be taking a very much a light touch in terms of the enforcement of this. Local authorities will not be knocking at the doors of people's homes to check whether they have these newly installed fire alarms, because we recognise that some people will take a bit longer and they will have a reasonable period of time to comply. But I think we all have a duty as elected members to reiterate the importance of households fitting these alarms as quickly as they can.
Can I remind all members who wish to ask a question that they should check that their cards are in and that the request to speak buttons are pressed. I call Eleanor Whittam to be followed by Alexander Stewart.
As the Cabinet Secretary said in her statement, the law has come about as a result of the tragic disaster at Grenfell that led to the deaths of 72 people. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what evidence the Scottish Government used to determine that these regulations will protect lives?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we have looked at the expert advice that has been given to us, and it was on the back of the work that was done post-Grenfell by the expert group in terms of recommendations that could be made that would help to improve fire safety, that these interconnected alarms were recommended. And it had, as I said in my statement again, had huge backing from the public. And I think it's the duty is upon us to do what we can. One death from a preventable fire in a home is one death too many. And if these devices can help to save lives, then surely that is something we should all support.
Alexander Stewart to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Age Scotland has highlighted for much of the last year that there has been continued anxiety amongst the public regarding tradespeople into their homes, particularly amongst older people due to the spread of the new strains of COVID. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the prevalence of the virus for much of the last year means that it is simply not reasonable to expect people to meet the February deadline?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I appreciate the concerns that have been expressed by Alexander Stewart, and that is why, in those circumstances where it is reasonable, for those reasons that he cites, that someone doesn't feel comfortable, or perhaps have been shielding, then that is a reasonable proposition as to why they would not be able to meet these deadlines. So we understand that. And as I've said throughout this, local authorities, which at the end of the day are the enforcement agency, understand that too, and are going to be taking that light touch approach to make sure that if people need a bit more time to get them installed, whether it's for that reason or any other reasonable reasons, then that is accepted. And I think it's important, and hopefully with the Q&A that MSPs will get in terms of the information that I'll provide, that will help to answer some of those constituent inquiries.
Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise as to how many lives the full implementation of this specific measure would be expected to save in a year? And for those unable to install themselves, given the current number of installers who are unevenly spread across Scotland, how long does she anticipate it will take to install alarms in every owner-occupied house across the country?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I think I said earlier, in 52% of domestic fire incidents, a smoke alarm had alerted occupants to the fact that there was a fire, giving people a greater chance of escape. Interlinked fire and smoke alarms increase the chance of being alerted more quickly, by all going off simultaneously, regardless of where the fire starts. And this undoubtedly will mean more people are alerted earlier and more lives will be saved in Scotland each year. It's hard to put a figure on that, but certainly that is the advice that we've been given by the experts. In terms of the numbers of people complying and how quickly people will get those alarms fitted, I suspect the vast majority of people will have them fitted before the 1st of February deadline. We'll know that as we get the household survey being carried out over the next period. But we do recognise that a small number of people will require longer. And as I've said in answer to previous questions, I think it's important that people are given a reasonable period of time to comply. And of course, we'll be monitoring that situation going forward.
Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Scottish Labour Freedom of Information request revealed that £500,000 funding for care repairs to provide this institution has helped little barely 800 people. Can the Cabinet Secretary say how many people have been supported so far in Edinburgh, not at end of the financial year, given an estimate of the number of households in Edinburgh who are still to comply with the regulation and make sure that funding is given so that all low-income, disabled and pensioners' households can comply?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, in answer to my the answer I gave previously showed that care and repair services across Scotland have supported in one way or another around 2,500 people. I don't have the figures specifically for Edinburgh, but I'm happy to write to the member if that information exists at that detail, and I'm happy to write to him if that would be helpful.
Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you. As previously mentioned, the standards for these interlinked alarms were set nearly 15 years ago for new builds and nearly a decade ago for the private sector. And I agree, all houses should have the same standards. Why did these regulations take longer to introduce?
Cabinet Secretary.
So in 2013, the Scottish Government published a sustainable housing strategy with a commitment to develop a new cross-10-year standard for housing. And we've engaged with stakeholders since then to develop our proposal for a new housing standard for Scotland based on housing as a human right, and we'll be seeking views on that in a public consultation later this year. But following the tragic fire at Grenfell in 2016, we made a commitment to accelerate the fire alarm elements of that new standard, and these regulations, which were introduced to this Parliament in 2018, will achieve that aim.
Willie Rennie to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
The Minister must really stop saying that the alarms can be installed for £220 or less. The figures are often far, far higher, and she knows that all too well. Isn't this a prime example of the Government's ability to talk a good game, but its inability to deliver? The Opposition even gave the Government an extra year to get this done, but it still wasn't possible. Lives could be at risk. So what has the Government got so badly wrong with the installation of this programme?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't accept that characterisation at all. I think there was a delay for good reasons because of COVID, and that was something that was supported across this chamber. I've made clear the £220 is for the purchase of the alarm system. The installation costs, of course, would be on top of that. However, most households will be able to install these alarms themselves, but where, because of disability or age or whatever other issues, people required support. That is why we gave £1.5 million to Care and Repair and to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service in order to help those more vulnerable people to be able to get those alarms installed. And I would have thought that's something that Willie Rennie would support.
Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A number of constituents have been in contact raising their concerns in relation to understanding their own alarm requirements, the availability and cost. While I welcome the assurance that the Council enforcement will be light touch, can the Cabinet Secretary set out how the Scottish Government will track progress on meeting this standard?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I said earlier, the Scottish House Conditions Survey collects information on homes and minimum standards for housing, and this legislation will add adequate provision of fire alarms to that minimum standard, so future iterations of the survey will collect data on compliance with this element of housing standards.
Jeremy Balfour, to be followed by Ariane Burgess.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her statement? I don't know where her officials shop, but I've just checked that every B&Q in Edinburgh has no availability until after the date. So perhaps you could go back and ask her officials where they shop. And secondly, I'm interested in the Cabinet Secretary's a bit more time and a reasonable time. Could she perhaps clarify what does that mean in practice? Is it days, weeks or months?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say to Jeremy Balfour, I was clear when what I said in my answer previously that in terms of online retailers with UK supply chains, and I mentioned DIY retailers locally, I take the point Jeremy Balfour makes about Edinburgh, but there are online retailers available with UK supply chains that are able to supply these devices. My officials have checked on a regular basis and checked as of this morning. And I would have thought that Jeremy Balfour and other members would be wanting to focus on, first of all, supporting people to comply where they can, but also to make sure in the dialogue with constituents that we are reassuring people on the points that I have said, that if people need more time and if they're struggling to get a device because of the availability issues in their local area, then that is a reasonable reason for having to have more time. A reasonable period in legislation is never defined, as Jeremy Balfour will know. It's a reasonable period in the circumstances that the individual has. But I would hope that Jeremy Balfour and others will reassure people that they will not be criminalised, they will not be hounded by the local authority in terms of enforcement, but we would expect them, when they can, at the earliest opportunity, to prioritise putting in these potentially life-saving alarms.
Ariane Burgess, to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement, and I welcome the introduction of these regulations next month. Everyone should have at least this level of protection in their homes, regardless of tenure. I ask the Cabinet Secretary to say a little more about the implications of non-compliance, as there are no penalties for non-compliance other than missing out on potentially life-saving measures. What are the key issues that people need to be aware of if they do not follow the regulations?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the key issue is that their safety isn't as enhanced as those who have these interlinked fire safety devices. We know from the experts that have told us that this potentially could save lives, and therefore the message from all of us, I would have thought, first and foremost, is that people should comply as quickly as they can. But the member is right, there are no penalties as such for non-compliance. The local authorities have the duty to ensure compliance, but they're not going to do that in a knocking on people's doors way. We are expecting people, though, to take this measure as a priority, as homeowners, to put this perhaps above other things in terms of the installation of these fire alarms. We understand some of the issues that will require people to have more time to do that, and as I've explained in answer to a number of questions now, what those reasonable excuses or reasonable reasons for needing more time would be. And the message to people is to do it as quickly as they can, because it could be life-saving for them and their families.
Fiona Hislop, to be followed by Christine Graham.
Many local authorities, including West Lothian Council, have removed care and repair services. Some constituents tell me installers are scarce, component shortages are delaying delivery of already ordered alarms to them, and cost of living pressures are causing practical and financial challenges. So are there any other proactive actions which can help resolve the real challenges facing some, but by no means all, to get private sector dwellings up to the same and important safety standards as other sectors, including, for example, some very public statement of assurance from the Association of British Insurers and where this leaves people in coming weeks?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I thank Fiona Hislop for that question? First of all, all local authorities have broad discretionary powers to provide assistance to homeowners where work is needed to look after homes or to meet statutory standards. Local authority is best placed to decide what assistance is provided to meet local priorities using local resources. The additional support we've provided to care and repair services is targeted to assist owners who are least able to fit alarms themselves, and it is not intended to be a substitute for local initiatives where those local initiatives have been taken forward by the local authority. In terms of any statements by ABI, my understanding is that they have been communicating actively with their members to make them aware. I'm happy to keep that regular dialogue with ABI in terms of anything more they can do in terms of public-facing messages as part of the lead-up to these requirements from the 1st of February.
And I call Christine Graham, and then I will call Graeme Simpson, who will be the last MSP I'm able to call. And I would ask, please, for succinct questions and answers so I can get you both in. Thank you. Christine Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary is aware that I wrote to last year, raising many of the concerns that have been iterated here today. So I welcome her statement. However, £200 is an optimistic figure, even for just the kit. Some people are paying £500 for supply and fit for a two up, two down. Can, therefore, the Cabinet Secretary advise how vulnerable and elderly can access the financial support she's mentioned from the Fire and Rescue Service? I wasn't aware they were providing it.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, again, I'll make sure that that information is included in the circular that is going to MSPs. But between Care and Repair and the Fire and Rescue Service, they're providing practical advice and support to vulnerable people, and we've had very good feedback from both in terms of that support. But again, I'll make sure that that level of information is included in the information after this for brevity.
And Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, I'm very grateful. The penalty for non-compliance will come if people have insurance claims turned down because they haven't got these alarms. Is the Cabinet Secretary seriously saying that that won't happen?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, and what I'm asking the member to do is to remember what this is about. This is about the installation of devices that the experts have told us could potentially save lives. And I would have thought that was the overriding concern and priority for every member of this Parliament. In terms of insurance, I couldn't have been clearer what the ABI have said about insurance, that it is a requirement to have working fire alarms. They don't specify the standards for those. They have been clear. That is what the industry has told us. But at the end of the day, everybody should make sure that they get in touch with their own insurance company if they have concerns. But I would have thought perhaps some members, whether it's Graeme Simpson or anyone else, would have at least welcomed the fact that this is a measure that could potentially save lives. I find it extraordinary that members seem to be against these measures being brought in. I find that extraordinary. And I would hope that in your communication with constituents, your first part of your communication is to reiterate the importance of complying, because this could be a life-saving measure. That is what I would ask you all to do. And the information that I will provide after this statement will help you in order to make sure that you provide that accurate information to your constituents.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And that concludes the statement. And there'll be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.